The Kolbrin. Second Volume. The Gospel of the Kolbrin. Previously called the Book of the Illuminators, having the authority of the Nazarenes. Chapter 1. Strength and courage be yours, and greetings to my brothers in Doiva, the Kofarals at Karimba. Know that I have been cast out with my brothers, but of the places wherein they shelter I have no knowledge. It is a time of heart-searching sorrow, for as the inspirational lights are snuffed out, a dark night of ignorance descends. They who oppose us are strong, not only in weaponry but more so in guile, and they have the support of the dark strangers. Hundreds of wonderful books, the life work of diligent hands, have been used to heat the flesh pots, and there is a constant searching of all which does not accord with foreign beliefs. Since there are many versions, though not all in conflict concerning matters we hold to be true, I have taken it upon myself to prepare this one for you from the writings saved in flight. Pitifully few are the books salvaged from the great conflagration and brought out under our gowns, inadequate undergarments for cold bodies, but not comfortless companions. Perhaps what I write here in my cold solitude will, in days to come, dance on the tongues of the multitude, gladdening the hearts of those who rest in greater comfort. Be on your guard, my brothers, talk well out of the mouth and eat of the wind, for uncomfortable abodes await those who place the tongue in command. In order that the truth may be properly displayed, I have united in one narrative the diverse accounts brought to these shores by the Kolbrin, in the days of battle glory, when the mantle of Herthia descended upon Inhokkaredug. Led by wise Eliad, the noble commander, they were compatible companions of the brave Britons. I have faithfully copied the accounts of that John whom we call Numa, who knew our earthly father, touching on events of his times according to the books which have been written and left to us. Here is the book of John the Enlightened of God and the book of the Nazarenes and the Illuminated Ones, but the book of Indractus and the book of Sayings by the wise Eliad are with our brother Luad and his band in Branset. These bring all who follow and fight for the cause of truth a message, simple but sublime, meaning one thing only: man can break free from the fetters of time, to spread wings of the spirit and fly to eternity, borne upward by an inspirational strengthening outflowing from God. No man lives and no man dies by himself alone, all must live by the efforts of others, and dying takes something from them. Therefore, when living it is well to give, for giving is not least among the obligations of life. When I lay down my burden, when I am worn out, there will be better men, young and strong, to carry the light of truth on high. They will climb by the steps I have cut, mounting by the ladder I have made, never knowing the artisan's name. They will perhaps laugh at my clumsy workmanship, but I pray they will not despise it. If they do no more than utilize whatever good they find, then I have served well and go happily to my rest. It is well to write these things, though, in truth, there is none to lend me an ear, but many who would ply my back with rods. Yet whatever is conveyed into the ears and comes out through the mouths of men, no matter how manifestly true it may be of itself, always tends to assume a form of less worthwhile substance, and it is subject to more misinterpretations and distortions than when it is transmitted through the inarticulate quill. What issues from the mouth is so often unlike that going into the ear, that surely between the two there must be a strange transmutter. This is no easy burden laid upon me. The light of truth guides men safely through the most troubled waters, but if that light be deflected or distorted, or if the fuel on which it feeds be impure, it may well become a wrecker's light, leading them to destruction. Light are the hearts attending the food tables, laughing and jesting round the mead horns, but heavy the heart carrying much responsibility. I am one who can overcome the distinctions between Jesus and his hearers, reconciling the crystal virgin with mystic motherhood. I can place the clear moon-filled chalice beside the golden blood-filled cup. I can combine the star-girt circles of eternity with the lowly cross, and the defeated suffering sun with the victorious battle-inspiring fighter. I am one who would welcome the day when the floodgates of our knowledge can be opened wide, so no man perishes through lack of refreshing water. Who knows what our angered assailants with dark ways, harboring concealed mysteries, will spawn from the far-ranging circles. They trail like shackled slaves after the grudged offerings of those who seek only worldly power, disclaiming the knowledge held by their firm-standing brothers. Let us who are homeborn stand as one in all things, and not least in belief, for we are surrounded by dark-bearded men with strange ways. Swordless, we can only appeal for a heavenly power to become the smasher of swords. In this woeful world, created from the three fountains springing from the spirit land behind the wall of black mist, we can only play a part which accords with our abilities. The clerk cannot become a sword fighter, or the husbandman a judge, otherwise confusion would reign supreme. The brick has its proper place and cannot replace the lintel, neither can the hearthstone become a door. So now I speak to you through the mercy of God, who has brought me to a safe, though cold and desolate, haven. Yet is not its very discomfort compatible to my work? For overmuch comfort and ease are handmaidens of sloth. My preordained purpose is therefore to apply myself diligently to the task in hand, sustaining myself and my quill by the bodies of beasts. I send you therefore my blessing and the true message of God, Aa and Dui, the Spirit King and Father of all. These are wholesome and beneficial writings, a river or words outflowing from the ever-living source of life. They are not unworthy of even the greatest king. He who receives them, safeguarding them from distortion and convenient misinterpretation, absorbing and practicing what they teach, shall not pass into the circles of darkness, but enjoy an everlasting upward striving life in the bright circle of light. Happy are they who, liberated from earthly life, awaken to a haven in the circle of glory. May the knowledge of the unseen God and the light of His truth be with you always. Above all, be strong in the light. It is not sufficient to be a light-bearer, for the light is a fragile thing and needs iron-hearted protectors. Fine words serve well enough, but serve better when supported by strong and resolute arms. Therefore, not only must you abide by the laws of God, ordained for the benefit of man, you must also keep sharp weapons for their defense. It is well enough to preach great principles to a quietly listening crowd, but the value of those principles are best tested before a hostile demonstration. May the strengthening spirit fill your heart, and the guiding spirit turn you away from every form of evil, both protecting you from every assailant. May the comforting spirit have compassion on your weakness and tend your wounds when you are smitten by those knowledgeable in worldly wiles. May the doorways of your heart be ever open to admit the light of truth and knowledge, that the inner chambers of your being be so enlightened you may there perceive your own soul in the fullness of its glory and power. The differences between right and wrong, light and darkness, knowledge and ignorance, are great indeed, but no man spans the gulf between and embraces both within himself. Yet men choose evil as well as good, and this because they find pleasure in it. The king lives in a palace, it is the place to which he belongs, it is a compatible residence for him. The swine lives in a sty, it is the place to which it belongs, it is compatible, and therein, wallowing in muck, it finds pleasure. The king enjoys beauty, the swine enjoys filth. The king for the palace, the swine for the sty, each enjoys its own place. There are, as you know, two spirit places to which the souls of men are drawn, to which they have an affinity according to their earthly pleasure. If these are of the light, they go to the fount of light. But if their pleasures are of the darkness, surely they must be drawn towards the seat of darkness. We who are of the light need not fear the spirits which project out from the light, but what of the dark spirits which are hostile towards the light? These are the unwelcome intruders into this, the earth circle of life, bringing sickness and corruption to whatever they touch. If we attribute goodness to a source of good, must we not also attribute evil to a source of evil? If goodness intrudes into life, is it not obvious so does evil? The spawners of evil are not united with the source of light, they have cut themselves off. For even as the tree grub protects itself from the sunlight which would otherwise destroy it, so must the evil swarm protect itself. My brothers, rejoice with me in the light. Love your neighbors, for is not love the greatest light of life? My strength is not untested in the solitude. Sometimes I am overshadowed by gloom. I think of the ways of life and wonder, what is man? He appears suddenly out of the darkness, entering the light of a well-lit performing arena where, for a brief moment, the role is played. He flashes in an illuminated moment of eternity before vanishing back into the unknown. Briefly, he dances like a shadow cast by flickering candlelight, to merge back with the surrounding darkness when the candle burns no more. It seems presumptuous of mere men to set themselves up as interpreters of their state, so sometimes I ask myself, who really knows what man is and where he goes? Well may so many inquire, who has come back from that mysterious region outside the circle of illumination to tell what lies beyond the depths of darkness, to relate this experience and knowledge gained. Then my heart rises above its conditions, and I see beyond the mean quarters, the privation, and the squalor. I know such a return has been made, that the shadow can never lose its affinity with the substance of its creation. Doubt is an earthly condition, imposed on men for their own good, its benefits no less great for not being readily apparent. It seems that knowledge of what lies beyond the enveloping shadows must, by the very nature of things, be withheld from the multitude of men. Certainty and assurance are manifestly not part of this earthly state. It is also in the nature of man that he should too readily meddle in things having an untoward effect on his mission in life. I mourn yet for our brother Lanvid, companion of my former days, the lightener of my task. Yet I grieve no more than duly, for his spirit has cast off the restrictions of the body and, taking upon itself a form of glory, flies on ghostly wings to the circle of radiance. He has left this dull world of heaviness and is now attired in garments of glory. He has departed to a haven free from the sordidness of earthly struggle. He has flown beyond our sight and hearing, yet he is not far distant, dwelling in the free world of compatible spirits. Often, in my solitude, I say, would I were a barren tree, bearing neither blossom nor fruit, for the pangs of fertile generosity are harder to bear than the woes of barrenness. I am often perplexed in my heart, for in worldly matters I am not a knowledgeable man. Yet I cast away these untoward thoughts, for of truth life must be lived to its fullness and cannot be unless it is utilized to make a beneficial contribution to the lives of others. Let us go forward together, for we are apart only in distance. Let us not be men of yesterday, whose eyes are fixed on the shadows of the past, nor men of tomorrow, preparing for events which never occur, while being unprepared for the unexpected. If we truly claim to have the light, then should we not be in the van and not the rear? Let us therefore go forward and take our rightful place. Chapter 2. When Eliad, our father in the faith, came in full flight from afar, seeking refuge beyond the confines of his persecutor's dominion, he set his holy stone in Lanavaloc. Here, when he spoke to them, the Druthen said, "We have never been without the light of truth, yet you seek to bring another light, strange to us, which seems less bright than ours." Then Eliad said, "Let us not argue as to whose light, lit at the fount of truth, burns brightest, but let us put our two lights together, so they may jointly give more illumination and dispel more darkness." The Druthen said, "The light of your teachings was always foreshadowed, and he of whom you bring tidings is not unknown to us. The origin of truth is immaterial, for it stands alone on its merits and should always be welcomed, being unlike men, who have to be supported by their lineage. The lights were put together to become one, and we alone are its inheritors. Do others have the three guiding lights of life, truth, love, and justice, which all must strive to express in perfection? Or do they know the three things to be uncompromisingly combated, irresponsibility, hypocrisy, and self-centeredness? Or the three cornerstones of character, spirituality, integrity, and individuality? My brothers, an awful darkness spreads over the land, and I fear for the safety of our light. Since the ravens changed their feathers from white to black, love, though esteemed in many forms, is not what it used to be. The love of man and woman has become a thing for lewd jest or righteous disgust. In the days of freedom, love dwelt graciously in a house of beauty, erected by the highest aspirations of men. They paid manly homage outside her door, those granted entry displaying justifiable pride in their achievement. Now, men batter down the door while under the whiplash of lust, polluting the purity within and call it freedom. Once love stood on a sunlit hilltop, clothed in modesty and decorum, but now the climb is too difficult for spiritually weakened bodies, so she is lured into the shadows below. There she has become a befouled, distorted ghost of her former self. Love and beauty are the reflections of God in the mirror of man, but the image once reflected in radiant loveliness is now distorted to ugliness. Perhaps we have failed, but we are so few. Is it that love now lacks the nourishment of sincerity, without which it declines and dies? Maybe, since we no longer control our destinies at war, men are less ready to strive for the laurels of love, while women bestow the jewel of their bodies with wanton indifference to the needful sacrifices required to sustain it. A new, unhallowed love walks the land, unclean harlots and those in whom purity becomes the shroud of love joining forces against the wonder once glorifying life. Love, for which noble-hearted men and pure women would once gladly die, now is so frail it withers at the first breath of adversity, or departs at the luring call of lust. Now true love can be found only where cats have horns. What has happened to the harp-praised glory of the past? In the dark night descending, my heart is heavy with desolation and loneliness. My only consolation is that I can still follow the path of duty, knowing the bud of duty grows into the rose of sacrifice, which falls to bear fruits of the Spirit. Duty is not the least of our lights, but in this land, among our people, it is the child of a barren woman. My brothers, with this I send the book concerning Jesus Ijawin, son of Joseph the carpenter and Mary, who, through his sacrifice to love and duty, became our own issuers. His teachings were brought to us by those who lived within the circle of his light and safeguarded by our earthly father in the faith, he being not least among the articulate ones who knew Jesus, and a person of no mean estate, both in the distant land from whence he came and in this no less virile land. Jesus was a fountain of goodness, fed by the bountiful spirit of eternity, a pure stream of wisdom refreshing the longing spirits of men. He responded to their yearning desires as a bee is drawn to the scent of roses. He came to fulfill the desires and longings of men, expressed in certain holy books but, more so, living unspoken in many unlettered hearts. For such is the nature of things that the tree springing from the yearnings of men shall not fail to bear fruit, holy books being likened to an egg containing the embryonic hopes and aspirations of men. In the holy books of the Jews, it is said that the Son of Man is the shepherd of men, and we here know how a shepherd tends his flocks. But Jesus came, not as a shepherd to drive, but as one bearing a guiding lantern to light the way through darkness. It was also said, the Son of Man is the deliverer of men, and while we know truly from what we have to be delivered, those in his own land misunderstood the meaning. Chapter 3. These are the things written in his book concerning John of the Wilderness, which was brought to these shores by Aristolas and is no longer with us. The father of John was Zucharias, son of Bacharus, and he was a priest at the temple, married to Elizabeth from the stock of Aaron. They were both strong in the faith of their God, obeying the laws revealed to his prophets, but childless and well advanced in years. Elizabeth had resorted to many shrines, praying for a child, but hitherto her pleas had gone unanswered. In the fifth month of the year, when fire was burnt before Gabriel in the court within the outer walls of the temple enclosure, called the court of the Gentiles, Zacharias was a priest at the altar of incense. Then a strange thing happened while he was alone inside, the people being outside praying. A spirit messenger appeared on the right side of the altar, and a voice said, "Have no fear of me, for I come to say your prayers have not gone unheeded and your wife will bear a son. He will become a great teacher, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, but you must bring him up in the ways of the Nazarenes. He will herald the coming of an enlightener who will turn men from wrongful ways, making them upright and strong in spirit." Zacharias listened, too frightened to speak, but thought, "How can this be when we are both weighed down with years?" The spirit messenger said, "He will save many from the effects of ignorance, leading men back to the fold of God, whom he will serve with the spirit and power which was once Elijah's. He will turn the hearts of fathers towards the welfare of their children, and those who have fallen away from the teachings of their fathers towards the wisdom of the law. He will go before the people like a brazier bearer before a caravan, like a prophet of old, to make ready a people purified and dedicated to the Most High God. When Elizabeth knew she was with child, she went to the temple and gave thanks to the God who had caused her to conceive, dedicating the child to him, according to the custom. Thus it had been with Samuel, who was given back to his father for service in the sanctuary. Now when her time came, the wife of Zacharias gave birth to a son. And there was no midwife to bring him into the world, neither was a birth bell made for him. Though all others wished him to be called after the kindred of his father, Elizabeth said he should be called after hers, and he was named John. At the time of circumcision, when many people were standing about, Zacharias became filled with the power of Inflowing Spirit and, under its influence, spoke as follows, "Blessed be the God of our people, who has given them the means of their redemption. He has brought forth a spring of salvation for us, fulfilling the words spoken by the mouths of his inspired prophets which have been since the beginning, that we should be delivered from the hands of our enemies and saved from those who hate us. The child of my body shall go before the people, proclaiming the way of God and giving knowledge of salvation for his people, with the remission of their misdeeds through repentance and reparation. Like the sun source on high, he has descended to give light to those who sit in darkness. He will console them in the shadow of death and guide the feet of men into the ways of peace. As it is written in the books of the temple, hear the voices crying out of Levi and Judah, never turning away, for from their loins shall come the chastening rod of the highest God. He will raise up from Levi a priest above all other priests, and from Judah someone greater than a king who will deliver my people." The people, hearing these and many other things, were amazed and stored them up in their hearts, saying one to the other, "This is no ordinary child, and surely he will grow up to be an unusual man, therefore let us watch and wait for some interesting developments." Among those who heard was one with an unbridled tongue who spread the word of these things abroad. And between the ears and mouths of many people, the events became magnified in such a way as to cause concern in high places. When the Herod who was king heard these things, he deliberated with the council, for all awaited the coming of a chosen one anointed by God, but the learned priests said this could not be he whom they awaited. For, said they, it was not possible that one with his blood could be either the chosen one or the deliverer, such would be an abomination. Then Herod said, "That may be, but let us bring the child into our own fold, for if perchance he be the chosen one, it is well for him to be raised among us. But if it be otherwise, no harm is done. And in days such as these, it is well to be prudent." Now, word of these intentions was sped out by a maidservant, passing through the ears of slaves to the kindred of Elizabeth, who hastened to warn her. They said, "This is a day of woe, for men come from Herod to take away your child and offer him up as a sacrifice." So Elizabeth, in fear for her child, gathered him up, saying to a manservant, "Take all that can be carried and meet us at such a place," and then she went to Zacharias. Elizabeth found him at his place in the temple and said, "Come, my husband, let us flee quickly with the babe, for here he is in danger. Tarry for nothing, unless we make haste, our little one will be lost to us, he who is the treasure of our life and the hope of our people." Zacharias said, "How can I leave my post in the temple to go into a strange land where perchance people will have no knowledge of God?" Then Elizabeth said, "O my husband, if you will not come, tell me what I must do to save my baby. I cannot waste time here when men come to put him to death." He answered her, "Flee to the wilderness of Sheba where, by the will of God, you will both survive. If they come seeking to find him here, or expect to find him through me, then my blood will be shed instead of his, for it is blood they want." Then Zacharias took the babe into a place beside the altar and kissed and blessed him, saying, "My son, treasure of my latter years, who gladdened my heart and made light the burden of days, now my cup of sorrow overflows. I am to be cut off from the pleasure of holding you, no longer may I feel my heart leap with gladness when I see your face. You are too young for my words to reach your understanding, and it is not my hand which will guide your feet, but go out strong in your dedication to God. To Elizabeth he said, May our God and the God of our fathers protect you. Elizabeth said, Dedicated priest and husband, pray for us both, that we may not be taken, and I shall be given strength to overcome the difficulties of the wilderness. Zacharias said, He who gave us a child in our old age will not take it away from you, neither will the child perish. May the protective power of God overshadow your journey. Now the men sent out by Herod were of his guard, and when they came to Zacharias and asked concerning the child, he did not lie, but said, His mother has taken him and fled in fear into the wilderness. So they who had come returned to Herod and said, The child has been taken into the wilderness by its mother. No food or water is there, but many wild beasts, and the woman, being old, surely both must perish. Then those who had the ear of Herod said, Surely there is something more to all this. Is it likely the woman would have fled friendless? Let us send other men, not of the guard, who will act differently. So Herod, being troubled in his heart, agreed. And three men with knives came to Zacharias before sunrise, saying, Herod has commanded us, tell Zacharias his life is in my hand, and I order him to speak truly concerning the whereabouts of his son. Zacharias answered, I am a dedicated servant of God and obliged to continually attend his temple, therefore, my son's whereabouts are not within my knowledge. They said, Our knives will open your mouth. But Zacharias was unafraid and replied, If my blood be shed, God himself will bear witness to the deed, and innocent blood never cries out to him in vain. When Zacharias saw he spoke in vain and no words would turn their intentions, he took refuge at the sanctuary behind the altar, his hands on the horns. But they stabbed him with knives so he died, for they were strangers in ignorance of the law. When the morning hour of salutation came and the priests went out, it was seen that Zacharias failed to pay the accustomed homage, and they asked among themselves why he tarried. Then one went from them into the sanctuary of Zacharias and saw his body lying bloodied beside the altar. A voice was heard saying, Zacharias is dead and lies in his blood, but the stain shall not be removed until the coming of one who will avenge the deed. Woe to those who shed innocent blood! Woe to those who let it remain unavenged! Woe, for one comes who will destroy the temple rites! On hearing this, the priests ran out, crying, Zacharias is dead, and an avenging spirit has taken up residence in his place. But the others went in and saw the cloths about the altar were torn and the carved woodwork broken. So report of these things was made to the people, who mourned 3 days and nights, after which another priest was appointed. The body of Zacharias was shrouded in linen and placed in a tomb beside his father. Elizabeth was alone with the child. She was old and found life difficult to sustain in the wilderness, the manservant having departed with her goods. She discovered a cave where there was a seepage of water and lived there until John was 8 years of age. Then she died, and the child did not understand, neither did he know what to do or how to bury her. But the ever-present God intervened in his manner, and some people who lived apart from others were directed to him, and he was raised in their ways. He remained with them until the day he went forth to herald the coming of the Deliverer. The people among whom John was raised did not marry, but adopted outcasts and orphans while they were young. They were godly people in their own way, but did not concern themselves with others. John rebelled against their exclusiveness, desiring to carry tidings concerning the coming instructor in goodness to the common people. In those days, there was much confusion among men regarding one who would come, and he was given many names and attributes. Therefore, none really knew what he would be like, and many sought only for enlightenment on this matter. Chapter 4. When John had grown to manhood, he reappeared in the wilderness of Bethimra, proclaiming, Change your ways, for you have fallen into error and ignorance. Return to the teachings of the law, interpreting them without guile, and turn your eyes towards the new light of the coming day. For one comes who will be the promised instructor in goodness, to establish the government of God. Then the people said among themselves, Surely this is he of whom it is written, The voice of a herald will cry out from the wilderness, Make a highway for God, let the swift rivers be bridged, the high mountains passed, and the rough places made smooth, for the impassable places will be crossed, and the wilderness made to flourish. Some came to John from the place of his upbringing, who said, Withdraw from the people, for they are no concern of yours. In good time, preach purification of the spirit and suppression of passion, but meanwhile you are too inexperienced. John said, Worthy teachers, you dress in white, proclaiming your purity, yet fear to put this to the test. Is your flesh so weak that it must be kept continually under restraint? Is the imprisoned malefactor good by his own desire, or by his circumstances? Is not the world a place of temptation so each may discover his own strength or weakness? Untested you can know neither and must always remain in a state of doubt. The fire hidden in wood gives warmth only when released. It also provides light and is useful. But while hidden away it is of little value. A tree left growing uncut falls and rots, serving no man. So too is it with knowledge and wisdom, for only when utilized can they have any value. Goodness is not assessed only by the things done, for the things left undone are not overlooked. John appeared strange in the eyes of those who saw him, for he was wild-haired and large, clothed in a garment of hair as were the prophets of old and bound about with a leather girdle, like Elijah. His food was locusts and bread dipped in wild honey, for he was of the Zophim who watched for the coming of the kingdom. He came to bear witness to the light which should shine in the hearts of all men. But the Jews would not heed him, for he used cleansing waters, which they did not. This, he said, signified the washing away of the causes of illusion and the impurities of life. He was a cleanser of minds and hearts. There were mockers, but they were afraid to come near John. Yet many listened to the message and were cleansed in the river of life, providing they were wholehearted in a desire to change their ways. John knew some were hypocrites, and he held them long under the water, for he said they required a lot of purifying. Few men argued with John, though it is in the nature of Jews to argue. This is how John testified when priests and learned men were sent to question him, saying, Who are you? He said, I am not the one you anticipate, whose coming is at hand. Is it not written, I will send a forerunner to prepare the way? I am that herald. Soon the one you seek will hasten to acquire his kingdom. He will be like a refining fire, preparing you for participation. I am one who verifies the prophets of old who said, Take heed, for the day comes which shall burn like a fire, when the self-satisfied and wrongdoers shall burn like stubble, so neither branch nor root of their wickedness shall be left. Then some who inquired of John said, If you are not the expected one, why do you baptize? He replied, I teach cleansing in water as a sign of repentance for the past and rebirth into another way of life. I herald the coming of someone much greater who is now born among you. He is one whose sandal bands I am unworthy to unlace. I use water, but he will immerse men in spirit power and cleanse them with disciplinary fire. He is the bearer of a winnowing fan and will thoroughly cleanse the threshing floor, gathering the wheat into the granary and burning the useless chaff. Then one said, No good thing ever came out of the wilderness. But John, overhearing him, said, Recall the days of our forefathers, when the wandering in the wilderness was over, and they came to a land where there was an abundance of milk, butter, and cheese, where the sheep grew fat and corn grew plentifully, where the vine flourished and all good things for the nurture and comfort of man were found. Then the people became weak in body, slothful, their minds turning to unclean things. They forsook the ways of God and had little respect for the teachings of the law. From which did they derive the most benefit, from the wilderness or from the land overflowing with good things? Pity me not for my days in the wilderness, but pity yourselves who have been denied man-making experiences. John said, Woe to you who have taken to the keeping of many slaves, for you, having robbed the man with a small plot of ground of his livelihood, are worse than thieves. You roll your eyes upward, saying, Never would I steal a loaf of bread, and condemn one who steals because of his emptiness. Your stomachs are full, but your hearts are empty of goodness. Take heed of my words, For surely if any man acts so, he bring another to wrongdoing, even though the other be in a far distant land, he shall not be blameless in the sight of God. Hypocrites, you cast a piece of silver at the feet of a beggar sitting beside the temple and say, I have done good, but how small the goodness compared with the wickedness done to those unseen. What of the disinherited ones, victims of your avarice? They have been driven from their homes and lie shivering in the coldness of the night, no roof protecting them from the night dampness. They huddle uncomfortably under rocks for shelter, aching stomachs denying them sleep. They rake the hard, hot ground with bony fingers and gnaw coarse roots with teeth loosened in their gums. Their mouths are dry and sour, and bitter unsatisfying leaves become an acceptable diet. When they crave for the relief of bread, driven desperate by mouth-watering smells carried on the air, and steal some small thing, they are harried by well-fed tyrants such as the slave owners among you. Take heed of this, for it is the law, if a hungry man steal because of the emptiness within his stomach, the crime is not with him, but with those whose hands hold the power. Those to whom John spoke said, Tell us not of these things, for we have rulers. We give to the poor outside the temple, but if we gave to the multitude of the poor, we would only be added to their number. Tell us about the deliverer. John said, From what do you expect the deliverer to save you? They said, It is written, He will deliver us from the hands of our enemies. John said, He will perform no mean task, but will save you from the greatest of enemies. Tell me, which presents the most danger, those who lay siege to a fortress from outside, or those within its gates, cunningly biding their time with concealed weapons? Surely it is the enemy within who is most to be feared. Therefore, I declare to you, the deliverer comes not to fight against the enemy clamoring outside, for the silent unseen foe within is most to be feared. Many shook their heads and said quietly, This man is mad. Then one among those who listened said, If he tells of the ways of God, surely those ways are strange. John, overhearing this, said, The ant cannot understand the ways of an eagle, nor an eagle the ways of a man. How much less can man understand the ways of God? One standing close to John said, If a man is ruled by two kings, which should he obey, the one who is close, or the one who is far distant? John said, If I answered you straightly, would you follow my advice? The man replied, Surely, for I am perplexed and would hear your words. John said, Obey the rule of the king closest to you, he who reigns in your heart. Now, John testified concerning Jesus in this manner. These are the things written in the holy books about he who will come. Then shall God raise up a new high priest like no other before him, and he will reveal God in a new light to the understanding of men. He will set the feet of men on the path of rightful judgment. He shall shine forth as the sun over the earth, removing all darkness from it, and will arm men with the sword which brings everlasting peace. His star will shine above like that of a king, its light kindling the lamp of knowledge, enlightening men as the sun lightens the day. He will proclaim the kingdom wherein the sword will be drawn against the wrongdoers, and the injustices of the poor will be redressed. There shall arise a chosen one from among you who will deliver you from your enemies. John also said, Already the axe is laid at the root of the vines, for was it not prophesied that every tree bearing sour fruit will be hewn down and burned? Therefore, do not be fuel for the fire, but produce the good fruits of repentance wherein lie the seeds of your salvation. The day is not far distant when each shall be called to an accounting, some enjoying the fruits of their labor and rising into glory, while others go down into darkness and shame. There was a time when many temple worshippers came to gain rebirth through the cleansing waters, and John said to some self-righteous ones among them, Children of the viper's brood, what has caused you to seek escape from the fate in store for you? Produce deeds consistent with repentance and console yourselves no longer by saying, We are of the seed of Abraham. I say, being of the seed of Abraham serves you no better than being one of those stones. When the people said, Tell us what we should do, John replied, No man wears two coats, so let the man who has two share with the man who has none. Whoever has a store of food beyond his needs, let him do likewise. A tax gatherer asked him, "What shall I do?" John answered, "Exact nothing above the amount fixed for collection, and never exploit the defenseless and unlearned." Some soldiers asked him what they should do. John said, "Never be unnecessarily cruel or threaten to bring false charges, and make sure you always live within your earnings as soldiers." Then a captain said, "What shall I do, who must enforce commands?" John replied, "Make sure the commands are just, and do not extend beyond the need of the circumstances." A man of priestly rank said to John, "Why do you not offer incense and sacrifice?" John answered, "Such things are not fitting for the Most High God, who is already full with all things and lacks nothing. Therefore, honor him by giving thanks for his benefits, and let your only sacrifice be dedication to his service." A priest among the crowd said to John, "Do you say the God of our fathers is not a great God?" John replied, "You know his requirements and whether these be worthy of a great or small God." Then some cried out, "Pity him, for he is only a waif of the wilderness, having neither father nor mother." John answered, "Have I not said, pity me not, for the wilderness was a goodly father, making me strong and hardy? Can I not outrun the gazelle and lift a great stone? No sickness eats my body, and I can bite through a halter line. What of these people fattened at the tables of their fathers, like geese prepared for the banquet? They say, we are the light of the land, but I tell you, they are an unprofitable burden. They say, give us white water to quench the fire in our stomachs, when every day they kindle the fire anew through their mouths. For things that pass pleasantly through the mouth often stir up strife in the belly." John was the light of the light, the herald of the deliverer, coming to purge the world of wrongdoing by enlightening men, showing what was right and what was wrong. For though men had the light of the law, many saw it only dimly or with distortion, while many interpreted the law to make it accord with their convenience. The true deliverer was one who would deliver men from themselves, exposing their weaknesses, failings and hypocrisies only that they might benefit, the purpose and intent being wholly good. Glory to the Supreme God reigning in the sphere above all. May peace and plenty fill the earth and goodwill extend to all creation. May suffering, turmoil and disaster quickly serve their purpose through the cooperation and understanding of man, so they may pass away as things no longer necessary for his upbringing. Blessed be those who preserve these words, and may those who alter them suffer for what they do. Chapter 5. The world is glorified through men whose lives are governed by dedication and duty, who completely devote themselves to carrying out the purpose ordained by God, using earthly conditions to this end. The desires and longings of the heart, the hopes and aspirations of men, will never go unfulfilled or be ignored by God while men are willing to rise to greatness through selfless sacrifices and devotion to duty. The highest duty to which anyone can be called is service and suffering in the cause of God. The birth of Jesus the Nazarene, who became our master and interpreter of God and the law, a worthy vessel for the greatest manifestation of the power of the Holy Spirit seen on earth, occurred in this manner. About the time John the Forerunner commenced teaching the way of the wilderness beside Jordan, in the year before Herod died, when Augustus Caesar ruled the Roman world, a babe was born. The father was Joseph, son of Heli, a carpenter of Galilee, and the mother Mary, his wife, who had been a virgin pledged to God and the temple by her father Simon, son of Joachim, son of Nathan, son of Eleazar. A decree had gone out that all who claimed kinship within the house of David should be gathered for enrollment at the city of David, called Bethlehem in Galilee. Therefore Joseph, being rightfully born into the stock of David, took the scroll of his parentage and went to Bethlehem so his kinship could be established. Now Mary, being then heavy with child, longed in her heart to be among her kinfolk, and she prevailed upon Joseph to take her, for Bethlehem was only a day's journey from them. The two, with a servant, came to Bethlehem at eventide, but because so many had gathered, the inns were filled. Then as Mary's time was close upon her after the journey, a man took pity on her and provided a cave used as a stable. There the travelers found shelter and rest. That night, Mary's labors came upon her, and she suffered the pangs of childbirth and cried out in pain. Nearby, some shepherds were tending sheep, for in the midst of so many strangers these needed protection, and, hearing her cry, went to help. They provided a shepherd's basket which was filled with straw and placed it in the manger, and the newborn babe was wrapped in the clothes brought for him. After 8 days had elapsed, the child was named Joshua, meaning one who delivers, for a spirit messenger of God had appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, "That which lies within Mary, your wife, is filled with the power of the Holy Spirit and will respond to the hopes of men." Later, men called him Jesus, and because he fulfilled their hopes and was anointed with the power of the Holy Spirit, he became acknowledged as the Christ. Now, the stable was against a hill, behind an inn where sages from the east were staying, men of Sestera, wise in the books of heaven, and of Nimrod, who carried the cross of fire. So Joseph sent for them, requesting they come and foretell the child's future, for such was the custom. One of the sages said, "It is strange indeed, for this child is born under no usual star, but under one that is a star in appearance only and not in nature, having a power not in other stars. He is destined for greatness and will motivate events touching the lives of all men." When word of this was passed around, there was much excitement among those belonging to the house of David. And many, remembering the prophecies of John, for they had passed his way, wondered in their hearts, "Is this not he for whom we wait, the consolation of the Jews and deliverer of men?" This displeased the people of Bethlehem who awaited another deliverer. When the sages spoke of the matter at their journey's end in Jerusalem and word came of the excitement among those of the house of David in Bethlehem, there was great consternation among the priests and learned men. They tried to discover where the babe was, but the sages answered deviously and also said, "His star points towards the east." An elder of the house of David, attending the blessing of the child on the eighth day, lifted up his voice and declared, "Surely this is he who has been promised to redeem us out of the hands of evil. This is he upon whom the power of the Holy Spirit will descend, bestowing strength, compassion and wisdom. Surely he will rule in the kingdom of God." When the king heard about these things and that a babe had been born who, many claimed, was destined to be the deliverer, he was greatly disturbed and summoned a council. With the council were learned scribes and elders who disputed among themselves concerning the babe. Some said that while God's anointed would be born in Bethlehem, the deliverer would not, for the birth of God's anointed in that place had been foretold by the prophets. Others said it might not be more than an enlightener who was expected to be born at that time. However, when many agreed that God's anointed and the deliverer might be the same person, the king sent 3 men to discover the child. The dispute before the council had been long, and Joseph had been forewarned, so when the men sent by Herod came to Bethlehem, Joseph had departed with his family. They went to the place where the kinfolk of Mary lived. The men who came did not search long for Jesus, for after the council had been dismissed, Herod slew the son who sat with him on the throne, as he had slain others of his blood. Later, Herod died himself, but after these happenings, the Romans did not bestow the title of king on any Jew, and it was unlawful for any man to claim the title. In this manner the prophecy was fulfilled which said, "A young woman shall give birth to a son, naming him our support in God. He will be the bearer of knowledge, discriminating between good and evil. But before this is given to the people, the land will lose its kings." When time had passed, Joseph and Mary came to Jerusalem and stayed at the house of a relative, a man strongly set against wrongdoing and well learned in the law. The 40 days having been accomplished for the purification of Mary, she came to the temple, and Joseph offered the prescribed sacrifice and dedicated the child. Hearing from Joseph and Mary the things which the sages had foretold about the child Jesus, the devout man took the babe into his arms and praised God in this manner, "Because the things foretold have come about, your servant is prepared to depart in peace. For my eyes have been gladdened by the deliverer of my people, a beacon light for others and the glorifier of your name. He will teach all men the ways of God and how to walk in his paths, so swords shall be made into plowshares and spears into billhooks, and peace will reign over men. Joseph and Mary could not understand the meaning of this and asked what was meant, whereupon the man replied, "I hold a sapling which will grow into a sturdy tree, under the shade of which many nations will find peace. Yet he will also test the strength of our people, tearing them apart in dispute. He comes as a separator, dividing the sheep from the goats, showing each his rightful place. He will place a sword in the hands of the weak and strengthen them, and the ungodly will be smitten." After complying with the requirements of the priestly law, Joseph and Mary returned with the infant to their home in Galilee, a small place in a hollow at the foot of a hillside. There the child grew up, developing a strong body and keen mind, for he was strangely talented. He was wise beyond his years and deft with his hands, and when old enough, he began learning the craft of plowmaking. His parents, following the custom, went each year to Jerusalem for the festival of deliverance. And when Jesus was 12, they went as usual, but this time taking him with them. Having remained the 7 days of the festival, Joseph and Mary set off to return home, but let the boy linger in Jerusalem, for a kinsman of theirs was also returning, and they thought Jesus was in his company. Having gone a day's journey and finding Jesus was not with his kinsman, they became perturbed and at first light in the morning returned to Jerusalem. It was some time before they found Jesus in a small outside room of the temple, sitting before an instructor of the priestly law. His parents were astonished at finding him accepted among learned men, and the teacher expressed amazement at the child's love of learning. But Mary scolded the boy for his inconsideration, saying, "We have suffered much during the search for you." Jesus replied, "Why search for me elsewhere, knowing I must concern myself with the work of the Spirit Father?" This saying disturbed the instructor. Neither could his parents understand the meaning of the reply, but they took the boy away with them. Henceforth he always obeyed his parents, but Mary kept these things in the storehouse of her heart. As Jesus grew up, his intelligence increased, and he was well liked by all, but he was a solitary child much given to wandering.